I'm super excited to share God's word with you. I don't know if you guys are excited, but I'm excited about it. when you like find out the one thing that Almighty God created you to do, like your personal sweet spot, right? When you find out what that is, that gets you pretty fired up when you get to do it. And so like here right now, like I've been waiting and waiting and waiting all week. Here we are in this moment. I get to do the thing that God has created me to do. And I'm super excited about that. I hope that you're excited about the word of God, like hearing it as much as I'm excited about preaching it. Okay? Are you excited? I get a little energy when you're excited. So if you're excited, I'm excited. And I want you to do me a favor. I want you to open up your Bibles. Open up your Bibles. To 1 John chapter 3, and we're gonna study that this evening. 1 John chapter 3, you got your Bible open? You got your Bible? You gonna open up your Bible? She's got her Bible open. You opening up your Bible? How about you? You got a Bible? Anyone ever got a Bible? You got a Bible? Warrior's always got a Bible with him, right? Mrs. Warrior's got a Bible. You got a Bible? You need a Bible? Who doesn't have a Bible? Why would you come to a Bible church if you're not gonna open up a Bible, right? Okay. So we open up our Bible to 1 John chapter 3. We're going to continue our series called Need to Know. So, hey, listen. So there's this God, right? And this God way back a long time ago, he spoke, and I don't understand it, so don't ask me to explain it, but he spoke and the worlds were created. And part of this universe, this vast universe that would blow your brain apart if you ever had any idea what it was all about, part of that is you and me, the human race. And according to his word, which is true, just for visitors, like when I do this, that's an amen spot right there, okay? So God's word is true, right? Yeah, it's true. And he says that we're his masterpiece, right? We're the only thing in all of creation that was created in his image to be like him, right? So like you're really special, and he made us, but way back when he made us, this Adam and Eve folks, right? I have a word for them when we get there, right? And they had a problem there, and he gave us some standards to live by, and they broke the standards. And because they broke the standards, now all of a sudden, all of us are born with this sin nature. Some would say, ew. Right? It's not good, but it's in you. You can't do anything about it, right? Everyone has it. The worst criminal in the jails and the prisons in this whole country, right down to the cutest little baby in the nursery, we all got it. We're all infected with this thing called sin, and there's a problem, right? And so because there's a problem, God, right, he loves this creation of this people that he made in his image. And since we're imperfect, we're broken, right? Because we're broken and the whole creation is broken, right? Listen, just like a broken watch can't tell time. And a broken mirror can't put itself back together again. And a broken car ain't going to get you to church on time. A broken person can't fix itself because, one, it doesn't realize that it's broken. It doesn't have the resource to fix itself because the only thing that can fix imperfect is what? Perfect. And there's no perfect inside imperfection. So the perfect one came down so that when he became imperfect, you could become perfect, right? The one who knew no sin became sin so that in him you become the righteousness of God. So it's resistance. So he comes down off of his throne in heaven, steps down, puts on flesh, comes down, lives a perfect life. There's perfection. Lives a perfect life, never sins like you and I have done. And then he goes to the cross. Your cross, say my cross. He goes to your cross to pay for your sin. And so listen, something has to die. Something has to bleed because that's what God requires for sin. It's a big deal and he's a holy God. Something has to die. Something has to bleed. So Jesus goes to your cross and he bleeds and he dies. He's whipped and he's beaten and he's killed and he goes into the grave so that you don't have to. And if you trust in this Jesus, he rose from the grave. Who does this? He rose from the grave. And if you trust in him, if you say, Jesus, that thing that you did, that's what I should have done. You did it for me, and I thank you for that. And because of that, I'm going to bow before you, and you're going to be the Lord of my life. And when you say jump, I say how high. All the days of my life. And if you embrace that Jesus, Lord and Messiah, you can be with him forever, you can be his child, and you can enjoy heaven eternal. That's the gospel. Have you done that? Hallelujah. Have you done that? If you haven't done that, you need to do it now. And listen, I am telling you what to do because that's love. If you don't say yes to that, you're going to die and live in a godless eternity forever. And that's not going to be fun. You think it's tough now? You don't like Donald Trump and you don't like taxes? Just wait till you get to hell. It's not much fun. And I'm lovingly pleading with you now to give your eternity to Christ and let him save you. Listen, for those who have said yes to Jesus, that's another amen spot.
Amen.
Listen, you're his witnesses. In Acts chapter 1:8, he said, "You will be my witnesses to the ends of the earth." You know what that means? That means when they see you, Debbie, they're going to see Jesus, right? She don't look like Jesus. When she sees you, Roger, when they see you, Jessica, when they see you, Tom, they're going to see Jesus, right? They're not going to see the way he looks. He was a man, I get it. You can grow your hair long and wear sandals. That's not the point. They're going to see you. They're going to see Jesus, right? And what's the defining mark of the Christ follower? Is it because he could stand up before you and tell and share the gospel and share the Bible with you? No, it's not. Is it because they're exercising, displaying their great spiritual gifts? No, it is not. Is it because of their obedience to Christ and they sought out baptism and they were obedient to that? No, that's not it either. Those are good things, right? Should you get baptized? Right. Should you exercise your spiritual gifting? Should you be able to share the gospel with someone that you run into? Absolutely, you should do those things. But the defining mark of the Christ follower is none of those things. The defining mark of the Christ follower, please put it up on the screen. John chapter something or other. Got it in there? Right there. That's it. Where's the next one? Right there. John 13:35. That's what we need. That's it. Your love for one another will prove to the world that you're my disciples. That's the defining mark of the Christ follower, not the other things. Okay? And so much so that the Apostle John mentions love 48 times in this short letter. This circuit letter that would go from church to church to church. Not, hey, listen, you need to learn love. No, no, no. Why? You all need to learn. Every church needs to know. Every Christ follower needs to know. This is the most important thing, love. It's in the center of our name, Revolution. We're changing the status quo of the way we live and the community that he planted us in. How? By serving them? Yes. By praying for them? Yes. What's the way we're going to change things around here? Love. That's the weapon of our warfare. It's love all the time. Love, 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 love. And that's why he says in chapter 3, verse 10, where we left off last week, he says, listen, anyone who does not live righteously and does not love other believers does not belong to God. That's a big indictment. But look at how important love is. You're supposed to live the way God wants you to live. Keep the commandments. Follow the Holy Spirit's promptings. I get all that. But listen, part of being a Christ follower is that you have to love other believers. It's that important. It's that important, okay? So let's read our section here this week. We're going to start in 1 John chapter 3. We're in verse 11. If you're ready to go, tell me to get going here. Yeah, you're ready. Okay, cool. All right. I don't know what Bible you have in front of you. I got a New Living Translation, but if you're a note taker, I would suggest you take some notes as we preach through this thing tonight. I think you need to get involved in one of our Rev groups at our church so that you can further discuss whatever we talk about here tonight. A lot of the things that we talk about in church you don't like. A lot of the things I talk about in church I don't like. But it's good to get together with brothers and sisters in Christ and reason this thing out, right? And so you want to take some notes, get into a Rev group. Chapter 3, verse 11, this is the message you've heard from the beginning. We should love one another. We must not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil. You guys know who Cain is? Okay. Adam and Eve's kids, huh? It's way back. No wonder why he's talking about the beginning. We must not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and killed his brother. And why did he kill him? Because Cain had been doing what was evil and his brother had been doing what was righteous. You know, why? Have you ever heard of a gateway drug? Not to mention, I hope nobody's struggling with drug addiction in this church, but listen, I'm going to give you a word here from the Word of God. It's going to really help you with that. And I think he can deliver you from it right here, right now, tonight, okay? Have you ever heard of a gateway drug? You know, most people don't fall into massive crack addiction right out of the giddy up. You know what happens first? Have a few beers, smoke a little weed, maybe do a line or two, and then before you know it, right, we're cooking. That's just the way it goes, right? Because when you it's so easy to do something super, super bad when you've been doing super, super bad along the way, right? You start doing some bad, it's a lot easier to be bad. And it's the same thing that's true here. If you're doing right, it's much easier to continue to do right, right? It's so much easier. Evil begets evil, right? That's what it says here, right? Why did Cain do this most heinous of crimes? Was it because he was a great guy and he was going to Sunday school every week and he was doing his chores and his parents put little stars on his chart and all of a sudden he just whacked his brother? That's not true at all, right? Why did he do this most heinous of crime? Why did he kill him? Because Cain had been doing what was evil. That's why. And Abel, his brother, was doing what was righteous. He was a good kid. And Cain was not a good kid, and he was practicing evil, and so that's why it came so easy for him to do something super, super evil. Romans 6:16 says this. This is not just Moses' claim. This is the Word of God. You ready? Romans 6:16 says, don't you realize that you become a slave to whatever you choose to obey? So what comes first, slavery or choice? Choice does, right? You know what happens when you decide to do something bad? You punch your card in the evil time clock, and you go, flesh, Satan, world, evil, I'm here, I'm ready, tell me what to do. I'm punched in, right? And so what happens is because you're doing evil, 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 I'm doing a little bit bad, a little bit bad, a little bit worse bad, a little bit worse bad, before you know it, you're in the pit. And that's exactly what Cain did here. He says, don't you realize that you become a slave to whatever you choose to obey? He made a choice of his will. That's why God created us, right? Beautiful. That's real beauty, right? That's real love when you choose it, right? That's not just fake or phony or some robot. No, you get to choose. That's part of God's great creation in people is that we get to make a choice. What can a lion be? He just eats stuff, right? He doesn't know any better. He just eats stuff. But what about people? We don't have to be like that. You don't have to be evil. You don't have to be nice. You get to choose which one you are. And Cain and Abel got to choose, and God's word says we all get to choose. We get to decide who we're going to be a slave to. See, what happened to Cain is he'd make some choices along the way to be evil, right? And the enemy whispers in his ear, and he chooses to be evil. And so at that point now, guess what? Guess he's a slave to evil now, right? He can't help himself. He's now a slave. He's given in his will to be a slave of evil. Now look here, it says in Romans 6:16, it says, you realize that you become a slave of whatever you choose to obey. You could be a slave to sin, isn't that what he did? Right? Which leads to death. In this case, we saw it actually happen, right? We saw it actually happen. We saw the Word of God come true right there, right? He chose to be a slave to sin, and it led to death. Or you can choose to obey God, which leads to righteous living. Does righteous living lead to obeying God? Not at all. Obeying God leads to righteous living. Look at evil begets evil, and righteousness begets righteousness, okay? Bad begets bad, good begets good. If you want to do really good things, start doing some really little good things. If you want to do some really bad things, continue doing some little bad things, and before you know it, you're going to be like Cain, and you're going to be just doing something grievous that you can't, and you're going to regret it. So somebody might need to hear this right now. Like you're heading down into a ditch. You've been taking some baby steps down in. You haven't quite got there yet. But you need to jump out of that strong current and jump into the other river before it's too late. Because otherwise you're going to be like Cain. So listen, before you go start cooking, drop the weed. Before you start sleeping around, stop looking at it. Right? We need to stop that now or else you're going to be like Cain. And we've been talking about Cain for a long time. Thousands. You want to be known for that one? I don't want to be known for that, right? I'll be known for something good. And so Maybe we need to start doing better now. Make some better choices right here, right now, that would lead to righteous living. Okay, can we go on? Okay, so we don't want to be surprised, dear brothers, if the world hates you, right? The world is kind of evil. You just got to watch the news. You know that, right? Nothing new. Verse 14. If we love our Christian brothers and sisters, listen, I just want to say, if you're reading a different version than this, one of the older, like a King James or something, we won't say brothers or sisters. We'll just say brothers. But what does it mean? Brothers and sisters. Other Christians, right? You remember that this letter is written to Christians, right? Those that are already following Christ. This isn't an evangelistic letter trying to get you saved. This is to you who's already a believer. So he says, and if we love our brothers and sisters, what does that assume? That you're a brother or a sister, right? You know, Matt, you can't be my brother unless I'm a brother, right? I can't call him another brother if I'm not a brother. You guys all get tracking with me there, right? So he says, if we love our Christian brothers and sisters, it proves that we passed from death to life. But a person who has no love is still dead. Anyone who hates another brother or sister is really a murderer at heart. Harsh, right? And you know that murderers don't have eternal life within them. I just got to pause there for a second because I know that there may be someone in this room who's murdered someone. Like, it's not a stretch. I know murderers. I got friends that are murderers. They've been in jail. I get it. I just want to let you know that if you're a murderer, if you've killed someone, that doesn't mean you can't have eternal life in you. The scriptures say that by no means would God turn away anyone who turns to him. If you confess your sin to him, 1 John 1, if you confess your sin to him, he is faithful and just to forgive you of your sin and to cleanse you of all that murder. Okay? So listen, this doesn't say that if you've done it in the past, even if you've repented, you don't have eternal life in you. That is not true. Okay? You just got to turn from your sin and embrace Christ by faith as your Lord and Savior. He'll cleanse you of all that. This is telling you, like, if that's who you are, if you're still a murderer, if you're going around with that in your heart and you're still doing it, you got a problem. There's no eternal life in you, okay? That's a present tense, the problem. Verse 16, we know what real love is because Jesus gave up his life for us. We also ought to give up our lives for our brothers and sisters. Amen. Amen. If someone has enough money to live well and sees a brother or sister in need but shows no compassion, how can God's love be in that person? The person who didn't move. This was being spoken of there. Verse 18. Dear children, let's not merely say that we love each other. Let us show the truth by our actions. Our actions will show that we belong to the truth. And so we will be confident when we stand before God. Even if we feel guilty, God is greater than our feelings. And he knows everything. Do you ever wonder, like, man, God, I just haven't done enough for you. Like, I believe in you. You saved me. You're awesome. And I just don't serve you the way I should. Do you ever feel that way? Honestly, I feel that way. Feel that way? And some of that is legit and real, and you're not serving the way you should. And you're not loving him, and you're not loving people the way you should. Like, I get that. Like, that's out there, right? That's in these seats right here, right now. I get it. But sometimes you feel guilty like you haven't. But feelings are liars sometimes, right? They're real. Like, you feel them. They're real. They're right there. But that doesn't mean they're truth tellers. Right? Because it says here that sometimes you don't feel it, but God's greater than your feelings and he knows everything. Like, he knows what you've done. He knows how you've loved. He knows, in this context, helping people, having compassion, helping them. And maybe you haven't done it enough, but he knows people's hearts and he knows all their actions and he knows your past. He knows what you've done. And listen, that's a good feel. Like, that's scary because you know he's there and he's kind of watching everything you do. And so the fear of the Lord should be in you. But also be encouraged that he's kept track of all that you've done. He knows how much you've loved. He knows how much you've served. He knows how much you've worked with him to build the kingdom of God. I struggle with this, he knows everything. My mind isn't great enough to even understand what that means. But I know this. 1 Corinthians 15:58 says that nothing you ever do for the Lord is ever in vain. Like he keeps a record of it. He notices what you've done for him. Even when you've done something and you think that it failed and you stepped out in faith, you know, Peter steps out of the boat, get on the water, right? And you stepped out in some ministry effort and it seemed to fall on its face and nobody got saved, no lives were changed, but he knows. He knows what you did. He knows, you know, over in the book of Revelation, Jesus is talking to all these different churches. And he says this, Revelation chapter 2, verse 2. He says to the church, to all the people, right? It's a group of people. It's not just like he's not just saying it to the preacher. He says to the church, I know all the things you do. I know all the things you do. I know. I've kept a record. I'm aware of what you've done. I know all the things you do. I've seen your hard work. And your patient endurance. I know you don't tolerate evil people. You have examined the claims of those who say they are apostles, but they're not. You have discovered they are liars. You have patiently suffered for me without quitting. God says, I know. I know how long you've been waiting. I know how long you've been praying. I know. Down in verse 9, he says to the church in Smyrna, I know about your suffering and your poverty, but you are rich, right? Amen. You're rich. I know the blasphemy of those opposing you. To Pergamum down in verse 13, he says, I know that you live in the city where Satan has his throne. Yet they must be in Washington. I'm just kidding. Totally kidding. Just kidding. That's a dig on both parties, just so you know. I know that you live in the city where Satan has his throne, yet you have remained loyal to me. You refused to deny me, even when this guy, Antipas, my faithful witness, was martyred among you there in Satan's city. To the church in Thyatira, verse 19, I know all the things you do. I have seen your love. I have seen your faith. I have seen your service. And I've seen your patient endurance, and I can see your constant improvement in all these things. Chapter 3 to the church in Sardis. I know all the things you do, and that you have a reputation for being alive, but you are dead. See, God sees and knows all things that we do. And he keeps a record, whether they're good or whether they're bad. He sees what you do. So even if you feel guilty that you haven't done enough, one, I would tell you that that's a good sign. Because people that are not saved, they don't care. So if they have this gnawing uneasiness inside of you that says, Lord, I want to do more. I haven't done enough for you. That's a good sign. I remember when I was not saved, I could sin like crazy. I didn't give a rip. Anyone with me? Right? But now I do it. I still sin like crazy. Not like before. Amen? Right? But I still do it. But now when I do it, I feel it. I feel it. So there's a change, but he knows what I do. He knows what I've done. I'm going to read on. Verse 21. Dear friends, if we don't feel guilty, we can come to God with bold confidence. That's good, right? And we will receive from him whatever we ask because we obey him and do the things that please him. You know, there's these verses in Scripture that kind of freak me out. I don't know if they freak you out too, but it's these verses that we quote when we're praying, like, you know, if any two people touch and agree on something here on earth, it shall be done in heaven. It's almost like it's guaranteed to happen, that God's going to do it if we agree on something. You know that verse? Kind of freaks me out, right? Because it's like, I know what it says, but, right? And then there's the other one, you know, if you ask for anything in my name, Jesus said, it shall be done. And so that's why we end up all of our prayers all the same way, right? We always say, in Jesus' name I pray, right? Why? Because we want what we said to get done. Like, I get all that. But here's another one here. This one's not very popular. Because this one doesn't throw the weight on Jesus. It throws the weight back on the dude in the mirror, you. He says here, and we will receive from him whatever we ask because we obey him and do the things that please him. Whoa, listen, I'm not telling you that grace can be purchased. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that you can buy your way into God's blessings. I'm not saying that either. But I am saying this. And we will receive from him whatever we ask because we obey him and do the things that please him. That's not my words. That's God's words. And so there's something about this obedience thing that evokes the blessings of God to pour down upon his people, right? We don't like this one. We want to sweep it under the rug because we're saved by grace and everything's fine. Everything's happy. He's got this. He says we can receive from him what we ask if we obey him and do what pleases him. So maybe the reason why things aren't flowing down from heaven to you like you thought they should is not because God is lacking resource or God is not, maybe he didn't put any, he's, you know, God's kind of old. Maybe he didn't put any batteries in his hearing aids. Maybe that's it, right? No, it's not. Maybe the reason why things aren't flowing down to from heaven to you personally, to your family, to our church, is because you're not obeying him and you're not doing what pleases him. This is not an isolated part in Scripture. Proverbs 28:9 says that God detests the prayers of a person who ignores his law. Why, God, hasn't this happened? Why, God, won't you answer me? I don't know. Why are you still lying? Why won't you do this for me? Why won't you help me with this addiction? I don't know. Why haven't you put it down? I told you to. What's the problem here? We'll receive from him what we ask. I love this. Whatever we ask. That's kind of big, right? That's a great invitation. We'll receive from him whatever we ask because we obey him and do the things that please him. Let's move on. Maybe God's convicting you of something. Maybe you need to make a decision that you don't want to just like have mindless hope for a better tomorrow that's based on nothing. That's based on some Jesus that you've fabricated in your mind that doesn't exist. The Jesus of the Bible is the Jesus that says, I will do when you obey me and do as I want. Do what pleases me, okay? You got to get to church. Listen, isn't that why we come to church? Get kicked in the pants a little bit? Aren't we really good at doing nothing? Sometimes you need to come here, like, God, listen, church is for God, but what God wants is his people to change. And so I'm not preaching to God, I'm preaching to you from God's word, right? So that we'll change, so that we, listen, I want us to be a blessed people. I want us to be able to gather up here on Monday. You know, we have a book out there in the lobby when people come in here and pray on Monday night, and then when they pray and then God answers, that's what that book is out there. It's not a prayer request book. It's a prayer responding book, right? It's where God answers prayer. And I would love it if our church, if we could fill up one of those books every other month. Amen. Right? Wouldn't that be an awesome church? Wouldn't you love to come to that church? A church where God's people are obeying him and doing as what pleases him. And then what happens when we do that? We get together on Monday night and we pray and we ask for stuff. And bam, right? Starts pouring out of heaven. Right? That's what it says, right? I'm not making anything up. You read it with me, didn't you? I just want that. I want what's best for you guys. Like he said in his word, to care for the flock that God has entrusted. What more care could I have for someone than to say, listen, I want God to bless you like crazy. That's what I want for you guys. And so he's telling us how we could get there. I would just pray that you would allow his spirit to prompt you and that you'd obey that thing, okay? Let's read on, verse 23. And this is, I love this, right? And this is his commandment. We must believe in the name of his son, Jesus Christ. Got that, right? Got that? You guys got that? Yeah. I hope you've got that, right? You can do every single good thing in this book, but if you don't have Jesus, guess what you got? Show me. Nothing, right? But if you got Jesus and you don't do anything, that's a problem too. But you could do everything with no Jesus, you got nothing. So we got to believe in the name of the Son of God. We got to believe in Jesus. I get that, right? Jesus is easy to love, right? He's just going around doing good things for people, giving them dinner, praying for them, healing them, right? Raising them from the dead. Easy to love that guy. Yeah, not easy to love that guy right there, though, right? Not easy to love you. Not easy to love you. It's not easy to love me. He says here, you got to believe in Jesus. I dare even say it, right? And love one another. Watch it. Just as he commanded us. I love this. This is the command that I commanded you. He's trying to make a point. This is the command that I commanded you, right? Commands. It's a big deal, right? This is the command that I commanded you. Love, you know, believe in Jesus, love each other. They go hand in hand. You can't have one and not the other. They go hand in hand, right? They're both needed. Commandments. They're musts. They're not maybes, right? Verse 24, those who obey God's, this is a bad one, right? This is tough for people to swallow, this one. Those who obey God's commandments remain in fellowship with him and he with them. And we know he lives in us because the spirit he gave us, the anointing that he gave us, lives in us. You remember that this letter was written to believers, right? He's written to Christ followers. I'm writing these things so you'll know that you have eternal life, he says. And listen here, chapter 2, verse 12. I'm writing to you, God's children, because your sins have been forgiven through Jesus. I'm writing to you who are mature in the faith because you know Christ who existed from the beginning. I'm writing to you who are young in the faith because you have won your battle with the evil one. This letter is written to Christians. And if you're a Christian, you're in proper fellowship with God. Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. That's the proper relationship with God. Outside of that, you've got nothing, man, right? That's not proper relationship. And he says, those who obey God's commandments remain in fellowship with me and I with them. So like we're a pretty smart bunch, right? What would it say if it said those who don't obey God's commandments? What would that say? They don't what? Yeah, abide. My translation says remain. Those who don't obey God's commandments would not remain in fellowship with him, right? The scriptures say that Jesus said, if you love me, you keep my commandments, right? You keep my commandments. Where is it here? It says, let me see if I can find this real quick. Where is it? This is big. Oh yeah, look at chapter 5, verse 3. Loving God means keeping his commandments. Well, wait a minute. The commandments is Old Testament, and we're in the New Testament church era. Well, this is a New Testament book written by a New Testament apostle to a New Testament church, saying that loving God means keeping his commandments. And those who obey God's commandments remain in fellowship with him and he with them. This is not always agreed upon by every Christ follower. We're a non-denominational church. And I, as one of the pastors here, does the lion's share of teaching, I believe that this is telling you that there's a way to remain and there's a way to lose. That's me. Now, you don't have to believe that. You may have come from a denomination that taught something different, and you have every right to do that. But I will tell you this. Whatever the case is, if you can lose it or not, I was talking to Jay about this week. We were talking about this. We agree, because we kind of differ a little bit about this, but we both agree on this. If you're getting after Jesus, like the Bible would tell us, love the Lord God with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength. He's a rewarder of those who earnestly seek him. Seek him with your whole heart and you'll find him. Give your bodies as a living sacrifice. If you're getting after Jesus, you don't have to worry about this. Right? So let's get past that. Let's put that in the rearview mirror. And let's just get after Jesus with all that we are. And then you don't have to worry. Man, could I lose it? I don't even know. That was 20 years ago I worried about that. But I'm so after Jesus, it doesn't matter anymore. That's what we're looking for, okay? That's what we're looking for. Okay, so here, I wrote down some observations that I saw in God's Word this week. We're getting into chapters 3 and 4, and we're starting to talk a lot about love, 48 times in the book of 1st. By the way, that was just the introduction. 48 times he talks about love, and here in this section that we read today, I want to talk about three things that love is, okay? Three things that love is. It's here right in the text. You won't see me making anything up, okay? That's why I wanted you to look at God's Word. Three things that love is. First thing is that love is commanded. Love is commanded. Now, love is commanded, right? So that means what? It's a choice, right? Love is commanded. It's not a result of salvation. It's a choice of a saved person. That's why it's a commandment. He wouldn't command something of someone who didn't have to make a choice to do it. It would already be doing it automatically, right? So when he commands us to love, that means we have to make a choice as to whether we're going to love or not, okay? Now, it says here that this message of love, it's from the beginning. It's from the beginning. Now, that kind of confused me because I don't really know exactly what John meant there. I mean, did it mean like... since God started this whole work of redemption, you know, way, way back with Israel and stuff, like Moses, Red Sea, all that kind of stuff, I'm not quite sure. Like, it could have been Old Testament that he was talking about since the beginning. Maybe it was the beginning of creation. Maybe it was the beginning of Israel. Maybe it was, I don't know. Maybe it was the beginning of the church. Maybe when he started to fast forward this redemption process when Christ Jesus came down from heaven and invaded this space and started the church. Maybe it was New Testament stuff. I really don't know. I went the other day with my wife. We were on our date night and we were on our motorcycle and we rode over to this Mojo Grill. You guys ever been there? Been there? That's good. Yeah. So a friend of ours, new friend, he told my wife and I that they had this killer dessert, right? It's like ice cream on these nacho chips. And like, I think it took like a year off my wife's life, but it was totally worth it to her. She loved it. But anyway, so I got a cup of coffee. It was pretty good. It was really good when they forgot to put it on my bill. Bam, right? Well, we get there, and the waitresses and the waiters, they had these shirts on. And it said, love is our religion. That's kind of cool, right? I don't know. You know, it's kind of a catchy phrase and everything, you know, because it's just a restaurant. But I was thinking about that, like, this love thing from the beginning, you know, religion has a bad rap, right? Why? Because it's a bunch of stuff that people make up. They take the Bible, they add a bunch of stuff to it. This is what you got to do to be a real Christian, right? Nobody likes that. But real religion, right, is love. Love is real religion. It's really good. And it's been from the beginning, whether it's the beginning of creation to the beginning of Israel to the beginning of the church, whatever it is, it's been consistent religion since day one is this, we have to love. He says, since the beginning. Then he references back to Cain and Abel. So I think we get an idea of what he really means here. Since way, way back, since I first started this thing, I've wanted you to love one another. Cain chose not to. So is it old? Was it new when it says in the beginning, you know, way, way back since the beginning? I don't know. God's Word says that he's the same yesterday, today, and forever, so I'd say the answer is both. See, most Christians know and they've heard that Jesus Christ said you had to love the Lord God with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength, and you have to love your neighbor as yourself. You've heard that, haven't you? And we definitely should do that, right? Shouldn't we? We definitely should. So it's got to be a New Testament Jesus church thing, right? Absolutely it is. Absolutely it is. But what some Christians don't understand is that what Jesus was saying there in the New Testament, he was just merely repeating the very same commandments he had given Israel like 1,500 years before. So it's actually an Old Testament thing, and it's a New Testament thing because God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Nothing changes, right? Let me tell you what I'm talking about. Deuteronomy 6:5, like that's super Old Testament, isn't it? You must love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your strength. You heard that one before? Right? How about Leviticus? That's like super Old Testament. Leviticus 19:18. You shall not take vengeance nor bear any grudge against the children of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Now listen, I want to clarify something. And this is the Bible and this is me. So I'm just giving you my perspective and my observation. Has anyone ever taught to you when we give the teaching about loving your neighbor as yourself, they go, and so who's your neighbor? And then you guys all answer, everyone. I would just disagree with that. Should we be loving to everybody? For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. We're supposed to be Christ-like, so we're supposed to love everyone. But this whole thing about the neighbor, look back in the text, back in Leviticus. What does he say? Who's the neighbor? The children of your people. The children of your people. Right here. Christians. Like faith. Right? Not like races, because Christianity invades all races and ethnicities and tribes and tongues, right? But the children of your people. That's your neighbor. The big call beyond the call to love everyone is to really love the other brother or sister, right? That's the high watermark of love. And so he says we're supposed to love the children of your people. So love for God and loving other believers is commanded, and it's nothing new. Nothing new. Love is commanded. That's the first thing that love is. And here's the second thing. You can write this down. Love is proof of salvation. Love is proof of salvation. Look at verse 14, right? Look at verse 14. I'm trying never to make a claim unless I can give you a verse, right? That's what we're trying to do here in this Bible church. Give you God's word, okay? So you can bend your will, your life according to what you read, not just what you hear, and what you hear should match what you read. Amen? If we love our Christian brothers and sisters, that's a big if. If we love our Christian brothers and sisters, what did I say the second thing was? What is it? Proof of salvation, right? If we love the Christian brothers and sisters, it what? Proves that we have passed from death to life. Right? It proves that we have passed from death to life. Look back at chapter 2, verse 10. Anyone who loves another brother or sister is living in the light and does not cause others to stumble. But anyone who hates another brother or sister is still living and walking in darkness. That's not good. That's not good. It proves that you have passed from death to life, okay? Now, does this mean that all people that love other Christians are headed for heaven? No, not at all, okay? A proper theology is this. Remember, he is writing to Christians, okay? He's writing to Christians. So that doesn't mean that all people that love other Christians are headed to heaven. It means that all people that are in proper fellowship with God, that's who the letter was written to, people who are Christ followers, if you're in a proper relationship, proper fellowship with God, i.e. authentic, real Christianity, right? It's evidenced by love for all, say all, you just indicted yourself, all Christians. And when I say all Christians, I mean all Christians. But more importantly, because it doesn't matter, this is a good place for an amen too, it doesn't matter what the preacher thinks. Amen. What matters is what God thinks. And this is his words, okay? Look what it says here, right? It says, if you love another brother or sister, it proves that you've passed from death to life. Okay, I get that. But it's all, right? Because it says in verse 15, anyone, that's, and who's his audience? Christians, right? Who hates another brother or sister is really a murderer at heart, and they don't have eternal life in them. And so some of you might say, well, you know, I love everyone, but there's just this one dude at church, man. He tricks me off, and he did this and did that and so on and so forth. But God would understand, you know, because, you know, I'm under grace and Jesus' blood covers my hate. Let me answer this categorically just one more time. You'll see it in the text. Anyone who hates another brother or sister is really a murderer at heart, and murderers don't have eternal life in them. Okay? What it doesn't say is that any Christian who hates Christians, like, it doesn't say that, does it? It says if you hate another, that's singular. If you hate a Christian, then eternal life is not in you. And he's already told us that the audience for this letter are the ones who have the anointing of the Holy Spirit in them, Christians. And so if you hate another, right, you have the Holy Spirit, you're saved. But if you hate another Christian, you don't have eternal life in you. And you know what? God does understand how you feel. He does understand that person that did that to you. But what he doesn't understand is why you feel the way you do, because he did the Red Sea, and 2 weeks later, they were building and worshiping a golden calf, but he still chose to love them. You see? And Jesus on the cross up there and asking his Father to forgive the ones who are hammering his nails in. So he does understand. But he still chooses to love. And so must we. His blood, my sins, past, present, future, forgiven, really. I would just say this. The scriptures say we're supposed to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. Fear has to have a fear source. You know this, right? And if there's nothing to be feared, I have bowed my knee to Jesus. I am eternally secure. I am in, and nothing can pluck me. Where's the fear and trembling? Fear what? What are you fearing? What's there to fear? Because the Bible says we should only fear the one who could throw you into hell. So for me, if my eternity is so set in stone, so covered in super glue, and that salvation is not subject to any possible loss, that carries no fear and no cause for tremble to me. Fear has to have a fear source. There needs to be something to fear. There needs to have some type of repercussion. There needs to be something to fear, or there's no trembling. And so when God's word says that if I hate another believer, when I read that afresh in preparation for this, it caused me to pause, and I was reminded again that this letter isn't about non-Christians showing that they aren't saved because they hate a Christian. No, this letter was written to me as a warning about what happens if I choose to hate even one of you. And this, my loved ones, I believe is what Jesus is talking about when he said the gate is narrow and the road is difficult and only very few find it. Because we're flippant with our hate and we throw it out and we say, the blood covers me. When all the while the blood of the one who bled, yeah, it covers you, but he's an author of a book. And he told us, if you, blood-bought ones, if you choose to hate another, there's no eternal life in you. It should make you pause and think. And again, I just want to say this. When it says another brother, does that not assume that you're a brother or a sister, right? They can't be your sister if you're not a believer. Brother and sister is brother and sister in Christ. Do you all know what I'm talking about? Just want to make sure we have clarity. A brother and sister in Christ. Okay. Debbie can't be my sister if I'm not a believer. She could be my neighbor. She could drop her kids off at the same school, but she's not my sister if I'm not a brother. Do you get this? So when it says you hate another brother, he's talking to a Christ follower choosing to hate another Christ follower. Fear and trembling. Fear and trembling. I wonder why the Bible says that we should tremble at his word. Not a lot of trembling in church. We need to tremble at his word. This should cause you to think and ponder the way you're living your life. Okay, love is commanded. Love is proof of salvation. Here's the third thing. Love is shown. Love is shown. Last week, we talked about that. How great the Father's love is for us, right? Awesome. Awesome. How do we know his love is great? Romans 5:8. God showed his great love by sending his son to die while you were a sinner, right? Awesome. Great, humongous sacrifice that speaks of your value to him, that he would give up his greatest thing and go through such torture and torment and ridicule publicly, spit on, stripped, and killed for you. How much love he has for you, that he would call you his children, right? His children. Chapter 4, verse 9 says, God showed how much he loved us by sending his one and only Son into the world so that we might have eternal life through him. God the Father showed his great love by sending Jesus Christ to you. So last week, the Father shows his love. This week, the Son shows his love. Look at verse 16. We read it already. Bring you back there. We know what real love is because Jesus gave up his life for us. Awesome, right? You know, we have our coffee house that's getting ready to really have our first real launch. We were just kind of a hangout joint for a while, but we're going to do the real thing now. But we have this little message in our coffee house, you know, and I've spoken to everybody that works there, and if you'd like to put in some volunteer hours, man, I would just love you. I think you'd be Jesus' favorite for the day. I'm just throwing that out there. Just kidding. But you'd definitely be my favorite for the day, but that means nothing, so don't worry about it. Anyway, I digress. So we got this little message, right, that we tell everybody, you know, if you work, this is what we're supposed to say. And it's so very true. People come in, they say, well, why do you guys do this, and why do you give away free coffee? Why is it free? Like an espresso down at Starbucks, like $6. How is it? Why is it free? Well, you know what? Jesus came to serve, not to be served, and we're supposed to be like him. So this is our way of serving you. What? That's crazy, right? Where do we get that? It's just some little creative little thing that the preacher came up with? Not at all. Bingo, right here. It's right here, right? It's right here. What? We know what real love is because Jesus gave up his life for us. So we also ought to give up our lives for our brothers and sisters. Jesus sacrifices himself to serve other people. So you and I should do the same, especially to those that are in the body of Christ, right? That's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to serve people. It's not just a creative idea of the church leadership, but this is an opportunity for you to truly be Christ-like, to be the hands and feet of Jesus Christ in the community that you've been called to, where he planted this church and placed you in it so that you could represent him, so you could be his witnesses to this city. Galatians 6:2 says this, to share one another's burdens and in this way obey the law of Christ. We're supposed to serve people. So that's why every week we get up here and we're begging and pleading. And honestly, I'm like, you know, I love you, right? You know I love you? I don't want to beg and plead anymore. This should be no reason to beg and plead. I mean, everyone should have a couple hours they could sacrifice to go and serve this community. Like, if we're going to blow out this thing and make it like the real deal, we should have two or three people working every single time, all day. Yeah. Not one. No lady should be here by herself. Never. There should be two or three people here all the time. And listen, over a weekend, we probably have 75 to 100 people in here. And we probably have like eight that serve. That's just not cool, man. So I'm just saying, like, that's why we get up here and say this, because we're supposed to have the same attitude as Christ, right? We can't just say we love people. What does it say right there? It says here, verse 18, "Dear children, let's not merely say that we love each other. Let us show the truth by our actions." Like, we can't just say we love people, that our church is revolution with the word love in the middle of it, if we don't love people. We have to serve. We have to serve. That's what Jesus did. That's what we're supposed to be. God transitions the author here, John, from a generality of being like Jesus, and he gets like super, super practical, and people don't like to hear this because we are owned. Listen, whatever you choose to obey becomes your master. We're Americans. We're owned by money. It's so awesome to have you guys here from the Extreme Tour who, like, you don't give a rip about money. You got none, right? It's like, I don't care, man. God will provide. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all the things I need will be given, right? That's what he'll take care of you, right? They said, like, money has a grip on people. And so it's our functional God, and it makes a very bad God. And so he gets super, super practical right here, and it's not easy at all. But he says right here, so we know real love is because Jesus gave up his life for us, and we should be like him. Verse 17, if someone has enough money to live well, that doesn't mean you have to be rich. That just means you have to be able to get by, right? I'm just getting by. Most of us are just getting by. But listen, we have enough money to live well. But we see a brother or sister, right, another Christian that's in need but show no compassion, how can God's love even be in that person? And listen, he's not questioning your salvation experience. He's affirming it earlier on in the letter by saying, you've won your battle against the enemy. Your sins have been forgiven by Jesus. You're a Christ follower. You're in. But maybe somewhere down the line, maybe it's a year, 2, 5, 10 years later, and all of a sudden, you got a couple of bucks in your pocket, and you see another Christian that's in need, like legit need, and you won't even help him? How can God's love even be in you? I would just question that, right? Love is shown. Love is shown. He says, if you can help another Christian, if it's within your means to help another Christ follower in need, then you show compassion. You know what compassion is? It's acting on a feeling. You know what I'm saying? A lot of us feel bad for the poor and neglected and marginalized and all that stuff. It's another thing to do something, but I commend you guys. You do something about it. They go to skate tomorrow when it's 95 degrees outside. Guess where they're going? They're just going to go find a skateboard park, set up an amp with a guitar, and start playing for kids that don't have hope. That's awesome, right? That's compassion, right? And how many in this room, we all know that there's hurting people in our community. We all know that there's people that are struggling with all kinds of stuff, and we acknowledge it. We might even pray for them. But how many of will you do something about it? And he planted a church in this community so we could be a people who would not just feel it, not just know it, not just understand it, not just, hey, I'll pray for you, but do something about it, right? That's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to be like Jesus. Listen to this, Matthew 9:36. I'm reading King James. He says, and Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, right? So we're supposed to teach. We're supposed to make disciples and teach them all that we know. Preaching the gospel of the kingdom. So he's preaching, he's teaching. And then it says he's healing every sickness and every disease among the people. That's awesome. So he's caring for them. And how's he doing that? He's preaching, he's teaching, he's healing. It says in verse 36, But when he saw the multitudes, all the people, it says he was moved with compassion. He was moved with compassion on them because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Several translations, they would all say that he saw how hopeless the crowds were, how distressed, how dispirited, how helpless, how confused the people were. And so what happened? He saw it, he felt it, and it moved him to do something about it. That's Jesus. And we're his people. And much like Jesus was the invisible image of the invisible God, now Jesus Christ has ascended to heaven. And so now we are the visible image of the invisible Jesus. We have been charged to make the invisible one very visible in our community that he's planted us by moving with compassion. Jesus loved the people. He felt for them. And this love that God has moved him to act to help them. You see? And so love for other Christians is not merely stated. It says right there, let's not merely say that we love each other, but let's show it. Let's show the truth. What is the truth? I was thinking about this. What did Jesus say? I'm the way, the truth, and the life. So you're not just, when you're doing something, you're not just showing facts like, hey, look, I'm a Christian because I do this. No. When you move with compassion to help someone, you're showing them the truth. What are you showing them? Jesus. You're not telling them about the facts of your salvation. You're not telling them about the tenets of our faith. When you act with compassion, you're showing them, they will see Jesus Christ. That's why he said, you will be my witnesses to the ends of the earth. When they see you, they see me. When you move with compassion, that's what Jesus did. They will see him. Okay? It is shown. Look at the end of verse 18. Okay, I already got that. Okay. So talk is cheap, right? Talk is cheap. Actions speak louder than words, right? And I heard this. Someone said this. I don't know who the author was. They said that it is lightning that strikes, not thunder. Right? A lot of this. Nobody needs to hear Charlie Brown's mom, right? You know what the power is? In the action. Not in the words, right? So listen, I'm going to invite the band to come back up again, okay? We're going to close out or even going to worship the Lord, but I just want to say this, okay? Also, look verse 23. Love is commanded once again, right? Love one another just as he commanded us. So love is commanded. Love is proof of salvation. Love is shown, okay? Love, above all other things, is the defining mark of the true Christ follower, okay? And so I want to take a few moments with you, and I want to pray with you. Because I think that there's some, I don't understand prayer completely. I don't. Nobody does. But there's some type of power, there's some type of connection that happens when we just get vertical with the Lord. And stop looking at everything else. Don't think about anything else. And just connect. You know, the scripture says that man, I lost my train of thought. Wow, that happens to me a lot. Pray for me. Wow. Oh, the scripture says that he gives us the will and the desire to do what pleases him. So that's what I want to pray. I want to pray a little bit just about that. Because I don't know about you, but when I was reading this text this week in preparation, I really, really sense that I'm not the guy that I'm supposed to be. I felt the chasm, okay? I felt the chasm between me and the way I live and the Word of God that I read and now the Word of God that I share with you. I sensed the chasm. And I don't like it. I hope that you don't like yours. And these are like really, really serious words here that John is given us, all inspired by the Lord, right? All scripture is God-breathed, useful to teach us. God equips, uses it to equip all of his people for every good work. And so the word of God tonight tells us that if we're not loving other brothers and brothers and sisters in Christ, the love of the Father is not in us. Eternal life doesn't live in us. And so I don't know if you have said yes to Jesus, but here we are today. I think it's, what, June 22nd, 2019. Maybe it was a year ago, 10 years ago, 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago when you came down some aisle and you said yes to Jesus. And I think that's awesome. And I would just affirm that right now. If you've done that, that's awesome. But the Word of God says, and so now as you've accepted Christ Jesus as Lord, so you must continue to follow him. And his word has been very, very clear tonight on how we're supposed to live. We are to make a decision of our will to love all Christ's children. You can't hate another one of his churches because it's not your denomination. You can't hate another ethnicity because they look different than you. Christ's church is every single person that has bowed the knee to Jesus in an authentic way. And Jesus loves them all. And so we are charged to love them all the same. Father, I would ask that you would help us with that. It's very, very difficult. This is a very difficult challenge you've laid before us tonight. But I would ask that you would help us with that. Maybe, Lord, there needs to be something specific. Maybe there's someone in our life that the truth is we say we love them, but we certainly don't live that way. That it's been a bunch of lip service. You know, your word tells us that there's some that worship you with their mouths, but their hearts are far from you. And maybe that's us. Maybe that's me. You've called us to something higher. You've called us to be like Jesus, to forgive and love the one who puts the nails in our hands. God, that's not easy. I can't help but think, Lord, that there's blessing waiting to burst forth from heaven upon these people if we would just obey and do what pleases you. And what pleases you is that we would love and serve brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, I would pray that this church right here, I can't speak of all churches, but I can ask for this church, that we would become such a people that love each other so well in such tangible ways that people would, they wouldn't look and say, man, that's a clique. They'd say, how can I get in that clique? I've never seen people love each other like this. Why is it that they do this? They would love each other.